What if I told you that there is an ingredient you have most likely been using for years that is moisturizing, anti-inflammatory, helps repair the skin barrier, and can even help with wound healing through fibroblast activation? I'm talking about Panthenol or Provitamin B5 that you'll find in many products ranging from nappy cream to the La Roche-Posay, Cicaplast or Hyalu B5 line. But what hides behind the name? Is there data on the benefits of Panthenol for the skin? What do you need to look for when choosing your product, and is Panthenol good for acne as well as for scars? Let's start. If you're new here, welcome. I'm Dr. Anne, a physician passionate about skincare and well aging. Panthenol is the water-soluble alcohol analog of pantothenic acid, the actual vitamin B5, or in terms of performance, the precursor to it, as it needs one conversion step. That is why it's often referred to as provitamin B5. As it is an enantiomer, so a molecule that exists in two mirror images, there is Dexpanthenol and Levopanthenol, out of which only the Dexpanthenol is the biological active one, so the ones you should look for in the product. The beauty of Dexpanthenol is that it is easily absorbed into the skin after topical application as part of a water in oil emulsion. Is then converted into pantothenic acid, which is converted into 4-phosphopantothenine, which is then again converted into coenzyme A. First of all, dexpanthenol acts as a humectant, meaning it increases skin hydration. Through the conversion of coenzyme A, it also supports different steps in the synthesis of fatty acids and sphingolipids, which are essential for repairing an impaired skin barrier. Dexpanthenol has also shown in vitro, meaning in the petri dish in the lab, that it increases the synthesis of keratinocyte growth factor as well as fibroblast proliferation, meaning it helps with the forming of new skin in wounds. It is frequently used in the treatment of irritated skin, where it helps reduce pruritus and redness through an assumed modulation of the inflammatory pathway. So, basically, it is moisturizing, good for wound healing, and helps against irritation, redness, and itching. As it is often the case when we are talking ingredients, most high-quality studies are obviously not done for skincare, but in medicine, here on wound healing in particular, and oftentimes in vitro, meaning not in living, breathing human beings. The ones done on humans usually show the moisturizing effect, the reduction of transepidermal water loss, and the reduction of redness, and, quite frequently, are done or funded by companies like GlaxoSmithKline or Bioconsumer Care that sell products with dexpanthenol. Which does not automatically mean the studies are bad, it is just something to keep in the back of your head when reading the results. The studies done on wound healing, mainly in vitro, as I already mentioned, are also quite often funded by these companies and do come to the conclusion that there is promising data on increased epithelialization and fibroblast activation as well as modulation of the inflammatory process, but that more data, preferably done on humans, is needed before we can say for certain that it is more beneficial than other semi-occlusive ointments used in wound dressing. Which, again, does not mean that these findings should be disregarded. They are really interesting, they just need further investigation. Dexpanthenol is not a known allergen, but as it is possible to be allergic to anything, it is always better to patch test, especially when using it on irritated skin with an already compromised skin barrier. It is possible that the low amount of reactions to it is in part due to the fact that it is often used when the skin is already irritated, so the irritation is attributed to the initial problem. You should think about that when you use dexpanthenol, and instead of improving, the situation gets worse. Other than the potential risk of allergies, panthenol seems to be well tolerated, not clog pores or lead to breakouts. We have studies done with different concentrations of dexpanthenol in the formula ranging from 0.5 to 5%, but in general, 5% seems to be the amount where you can see the most beneficial effects. There's also no increase in adverse effects with increasing percentages. 5% is tolerated as good as 0.5%, so the consensus is that 5% is what you should look for in your products. It is important to keep in mind that whether or not a specific ingredient will clog your pores not only depends on the ingredient itself, but just as much on the formulation it is used in. Panthenol is used both in oil in water as well as in water in oil formulations that might be different in terms of their potential to clog pores. When taken orally as supplement, panthenol seems to reduce the number of active acne lesions over the course of 12 weeks, but that is of course not transferable to topical application. As dexpanthenol seems to reduce inflammation and encourage wound healing without a tendency to clog pores, it is safe to assume though that it will be beneficial when used for acneic skin. The use of dexpanthenol topically in the treatment of patients after skin transplantation or after burns has shown beneficial effects on scar formation with more elastic and solid tissue regeneration. That seems in part to be due to the stimulation of epithelialization and granulation and in part due to the reduction in transepidermal water loss with accelerated epidermal regeneration. For optimal results, the heavier water in oil emulsions are what is used. There was a study done looking at the effects of panthenol supplementation with 4.4 gram pantothenic acid taken twice a day, so 8.8 gram per day in total, that showed a reduction in the number of acne lesions, but in that study the pantothenic acid was taken in form of a pill with several other ingredients, so it can't safely be said that the positive effects were due to it alone. As pantothenic acid is abundant in foods like meat, eggs, avocado, cabbage, broccoli and the likes, deficiency is rare outside specific diseases, so I personally, not a nutritionist, do not think supplementation is needed. Should you decide to take it though, it is water soluble, so any excess will be peed out. I said in the introduction that most of us have most likely been using dexpanthenol for years. The first ointment with dexpanthenol was released in 1944 and has since been used in nappy rash creams to protect cracked nipples in nursing people and to treat hands that need frequent washing. Commonly known as bepanthen with 5% dexpanthenol, but La Roche-Posay also used it a lot in the Cica Plus line I talked more about earlier this month, with the La Roche-Posay Cica Plus Bone B5 Plus being the best known one. I will leave some suggestions in the description box below. Panthenol in the form of dexpanthenol is moisturizing, helps with barrier repair and potentially with wound healing, so is an ingredient to look for in irritated skin and to prevent scarring in wounds. Adverse reactions are rare but always possible, and it can be used every day, even multiple times daily. The concentration to look for is around 5%, which is what is found in bepanthen or the La Roche-Posay Cica Plus products. If there's anything you would like to add, please do so in the comments below. I will link to more videos you might find interesting on the screen and at links to my Instagram, blog and Patreon account in the description box. See you soon, bye!